Welcome back to the Thessalian Plain. I'm Derek Pitman, and I'm joined by Lawrence Shaw. For the last 5 years, we've been involved in an international research project at Vlochos on the plains of Thessaly in central Greece, investigating the remains of an ancient city that now lies hidden beneath the scrub. Using multiple archaeological techniques, the team are gradually uncovering the site's story and have identified four key phases of activity stretching 1,000 years. Our recent research has focused on the settlement from the Hellenistic period. That's just after the time of Alexander the Great, around the 3rd century BCE, as well as its reoccupation some 500 years later. For our latest trip, we've got just 2 weeks to carry out an extensive geophysical survey of the Roman period phase. Or at least, that was the plan anyway. Recent heavy rainfall has affected the results. So in our final week, we're focusing our attentions on areas higher up the hill, including the site of a potential temple. Lawrence also has a hunch about another part of the site he'd like to investigate further. Meanwhile, just a few kilometres from the site, the team have uncovered some fragmentary clues that might link the wider area to known historical figures from the ancient world.
Welcome to beautiful Vlochos, 300 kilometres northeast of Athens and 80 kilometres inland from the coast. The archaeological site we are currently investigating as part of an ongoing collaboration between local Greek archaeologists and the Swedish Institute of Athens is an ancient polis, or city, one of many in the region of Thessaly. The city's original name, as it was known to inhabitants of the ancient world, so far eludes us, and the complexity of the archaeology leaves us with more questions than answers. However, we hope that today's techniques will help the project shed more light on the site's incredible past. To the untrained eye, it could be any other hillside, but when you know what you're looking for, there's archaeology all around us, from protruding stonework.
There are some indications of towers as well that are barely visible.
To small finds that have found their way to the surface.
So this is your standard Roman diningware for the early Byzantine period, and it is what everybody's eating off of. This stuff looks like ARS, so African red slip, which comes from Tunisia.
Stelio, calimera.
Hello, Derek.
What have you got here?
So we have some surface pottery finds from just walking around the site.
Oh, nice one.
Yeah. So this, for example, it's a toe of a transport amphora, those large pointy pottery, and this is just the end bit of it. And they were used in antiquity to transport goods such as wine, olive oil, grain, all over from the Mediterranean. And it shows trade, and it shows that, you know, they were bringing other goods from other areas in Vlochos, for example.
That's really interesting. So that would have been one of those huge, large, thin vessels.
Yes, exactly.
That's incredible. And it would have come from somewhere else to this site.
Yeah, we don't know yet from where, but we'll find out.
That's really exciting. How about this big chunk here?
Yeah, so this one, this is the rim of a pithos, so a huge storage vessel. These things were put inside holes in the ground in houses or other buildings to keep cold the goods, so that it would store grain or olive oil or other sort of goods in these. And as you can see from the rim, it would have been just the rim somewhere about this large, and they can reach up to 1 meter or 2 meters tall.
That's incredible. So that's a classical Hellenistic version of a refrigerator.
Yeah, exactly.
So what about these two smaller things?
Yeah, so this, for example, is the base of a cup or a plate. As you can see, it's black glaze, this black bit in the middle. And they're very useful because they tell us a lot about dating.
Okay.
And this dates to the 5th or 4th century BC.
Wow.
So a dead center in the classical period. Whereas this one, as you can see, it's probably a plate or a large bowl. It's a lot coarser. There's no decoration or any way to make it nicer. So this probably dates to the late Roman period.
That's incredible. So those two fragments, although we found them within a few meters of each other, have got, what, 1,000 years between them?
Yeah, almost. Yes, exactly.
That's incredible. Thank you so much, Stelios.
Thank you.
Just a few kilometers south of our site is the modern town of Palamas.
While Lawrence is finishing up the survey on site, I've come over to a local church where there's a really interesting inscription in the wall, which we're currently recording and investigating. Lewis, how's it going?
Hi, Derek. How are you?
Not too bad. So can you talk us through what you're doing?
Sure. So we have an inscribed stele here, spoliated high on the church wall. And I'm looking at the text on it, which is in Latin, and trying to do a kind of partial or preliminary reading of it.
Wow, that's incredible. Could you talk through what spoliated means?
Spoliated, yes. So it's been moved from its original context. Mm. So originally that stone slab was somewhere far away from here.
Oh, wow. Could it be associated with our site? Is it?
It could be. It could be from this region or somewhere in the surrounds.
Excellent. So you say it's in Latin, but can you read it? Can you tell us what it says?
I can. So what it says is that it's the property of the emperor, imperator, Commodus, Augustus, Pius, Felix, and that the stone was placed by a chap called Aurelius Jason.
Wow.
And he was a procurator.
So. That's incredibly specific. So what can that tell us about the period at the time? Can it give us any insight into this area?
It certainly can. So what the inscription suggests is that somewhere around here there was some property of an emperor, and that particular Greek individual was involved in marking out that property in some way. Now I think the stone we have here is something that's called a terminus, a boundary stone. So it sat at the borders of imperial property.
Okay, so that was right on the border between two areas.
Two different types of land or property.
Absolutely. So how about the stone itself? Looking at it in the church, it looks very different to everything else. Can the stone itself tell us anything?
It certainly can. So the material is very, very expensive. It's pink granite. It's high prestige. So we see similar stone used in, for example, the Pantheon in Rome. The incredible monumental columns there are made out of this material.
Wow.
And the kind of standard quarries for this material were in Egypt, the Aswan quarries.
Wow, so that stone there, which was found possibly somewhere near our site, could have come all the way from Egypt.
It could have.
Wow, that's incredible.
Rather incredible.
So you say the name on there is Commodus. Mm. Can that tell us anything about the stone or the site?
Absolutely. So Commodus was an emperor from around 180 to 192. He was the son of Marcus Aurelius and Faustina. So we can say something about the date just from that. But more than that, he has a specific epithet on the inscription, Felix, which means fortunate, or it means lucky. Mm. And he only assumed that epithet after 185, and then he died in 192.
Wow, so a 7-year period.
So we can date that stele, that boundary marker, to that period.
That's absolutely incredible. And you say he's the son of Marcus Aurelius. Is that the same character as in the movie Gladiator?
Yes. So you may have seen Joaquin Phoenix play Commodus in the movie Gladiator.
So in the movie, Commodus was a pretty bad character.
He was the villain.
But what about Commodus in real life?
He had a kind of complex story. He came to power really early in his life. He was already a consul by 15. And when he assumed power in 180 after his father had died, there was a massive burden on him. And he had, there were various kind of conspiracies, and they kind of deeply affected him and his character. And so one could say that perhaps his life events, affected who he was as a person. But some of the fun things are that he did like to fight in the arena.
He fought himself in the arena.
He fought himself in the arena. He fought animals and he fought people. And supposedly he didn't kill any of the people.
Okay. So maybe not such a bad guy. But a complex guy, So we're out here, obviously, to read and understand this inscription.
Yes.
But how are we actually recording it? How do you take a good record of something like this?
We're taking essentially a range of shots, a range of photos of the inscription and then using it to produce a 3D reconstruction. Okay. Then we take that reconstruction elsewhere and we use it to kind of think through any more implications around the inscriptions.
Excellent. In that case, I'll leave you to it. Thank you, Lars.
Now, this isn't the only stelae to be discovered nearby that might offer clues to the city and its inhabitants. This intricate example, now on display at the Archaeological Museum of Karditsa, was originally discovered in the fields surrounding our site. While the commonest terminus dates from the Roman period, in the late 2nd century CE, this particular example is much earlier, a funerary stelae from the 2nd to 3rd century BCE. The inscription, notably written in Greek rather than Latin, reads Megalocleas, the name of the specific individual whose name it commemorates. Presumably, judging by the quality of the stonework, somebody of means. So we have the names of some of the people who inhabited, worked, or ruled over this city some 2,000 years ago. Yet still, the identity of the city itself remains a mystery.
I've just come back to the site after a couple of days doing survey elsewhere. And I know it's pretty misty, but I'm pretty sure this isn't where I left the survey team. Last time I saw them, they were up on the hill looking at the possible temple area. Lawrence, what are you doing over here?
How are you doing?
This isn't where I left you.
Well, I told you I had a surprise or a secret area I wanted to target, didn't I?
So what brings you over here?
Well, I guess, when did you see me last?
You were just up on the temple area with Rich.
Well, we tried the courtyard villa. We tried the temple.
Yeah.
And it's just really ephemeral. It's really hard to see. It's too, like you said, it's just too wet. So yeah. The results aren't as exciting as we were hoping.
I think I can get a sense of the moisture issues today.
But we do have some pretty monumental stuff on the site.
Yeah, yeah.
And I don't know if you remember in 2017 when we did the Big Mag survey, we got the ancient Hellenistic gatehouse.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
And that's sort of just within the boundary of the shrunken Romans.
It is, isn't it?
Well.
It could have been used in both phases.
Exactly that. So we're targeting that because we can find some of the stones on the surface.
Yeah.
It's pretty spectacular. And the results are looking good. Mm-hmm. So we're slightly expanding to try and catch the Roman gate as well, which is sort of just behind
you. Yeah, that would be just about here, wouldn't it?
Yeah. Right. So not all lost. We do have some really nice results. We can see, we can start to see the outline of the gate, the Hellenistic gate. So the results were good enough to warrant us expanding and hopefully get some decent results before the week's out.
Well, it'd be wonderful, wouldn't it? So it's the last day, and today we're looking for the intersection between the old classical Hellenistic landscape and the Roman times.
Exactly that.
Wow, fingers crossed.
So, Lawrence has finally revealed his mystery survey location. And it turns out it was an area we already knew something about, the large courtyard gate leading to the Hellenistic settlement.
Yes, but don't overlook the obvious, Derek. Sometimes it pays to revisit an area that's already provided good data in the past. There's always new information to be uncovered. We came here with the aim of finding out more about the part of the site that was re-inhabited in the Roman period. But with too much moisture in the soil to collect good results, we next tried moving up the slope where the ground should have been drier to investigate a possible temple. But failing that, we refocused our efforts once again, this time on a Hellenistic courtyard gate.
With standing archaeology already visible in places above the surface, we may be able to get a better understanding of the structures hidden beneath the ground. The team have been at it, working hard to cover as much ground as possible in the time remaining. Already the results are looking more promising, but we'll have to wait until we've downloaded and processed the data to see the full picture.
Here we go. Bit nervous.
So you got 6 grids done today. The guys have worked pretty hard, to be fair.
You've gone all around the gate, haven't you?
Yeah. So we've done, we've got the gate encapsulated. We should have 2 phases of walls.
Yeah.
And we've just gone a bit, just because of the way the grids are, we've gone a bit further south.
So you've gone outside the gate?
Outside the gate towards the drain, the modern drain.
But, up towards the canal.
Yeah, that's right.
Right. Bear with me, pal. Oh, wall looks good. That's beautiful.
Oh, baby.
Oh, you've got the opening of the gate perfectly. Look at that.
Nice. So it actually kicks out again from the wall.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then we've got little buildings going on the outside of the gate.
That's stunning. Let me just do some processing.
Oh, that was all worth it.
That gate is incredible.
That's another gate there, isn't
it? That's the Roman gate.
That's the Roman gate.
Do you know what? I think the grain's drying a bit. That is incredible.
That's worked so well.
Oh, we're going to have to come back.
Told you it was the place to survey.
It is the place to survey. That resolution is stunning. Well done, mate. Well done.
Oh, my word.
Success! After a frustrating start, the geophysics has finally come up with the goods. Our latest survey has added to the picture immensely, revealing new details to the courtyard gate and surrounding area in amazing resolution. And it looks like we're on a roll, because our luck keeps coming. Having shifted our focus to this area for the geophysics, our team member Ian Randall made an even more incredible discovery.
What are you up to down there, mate?
Whoa, it's interesting actually. So we were looking at the res data from today.
Yeah, the entranceway is just over.
Just literally the other side of you. We picked up the entrance to it, which gives us a pretty good angle of what way the sort of entrance road should be coming from. And Ian was down here earlier while we were doing the survey. He mentioned he'd seen some pretty big blocks that seemed to have been washed out of the sort of canal here.
Yeah, yeah, you can see they've been cut as the canal came through. That's
yeah,
really interesting.
So we've got this one here. You've got one directly opposite. Can you see the one over there?
Yeah.
And underneath this tree, there are three or four still intact. Can you see those in there?
Yeah, so those are in situ.
They're in situ.
Incredible.
So that, I mean, Ian measured them. And it was, how big should the road be?
Well, we know our avenue's about 8 to 8.5 metres.
Guess how big it was?
8.5 metres.
8.5 metres.
That's incredible. So hang on, I just need to think about this. So we've got fairly substantial architecture at an 8 metre width. So this could be a bridge, couldn't it?
I think so. If you also, you can see it here actually. There's some packing material below all the, some of these substantial, blocks. So I think we got something, and even on the one across the river there, can you see all the rubble beneath the
we've never seen the river this low before, so this is,
which is bonkers how much it's rained.
yeah I know. I mean, this is staggering.
Well, we'd expect to find a bridge around here though, wouldn't we?
It's exactly where it should be, yeah, but to see it in section like that, it's incredible.
Brand new as well.
We should talk to Robin.
So we came here first time in 2016, and we walked around this area. We couldn't see anything.
Many times we've been here also.
And it aligns.
Very impressive, really very impressive.
Yeah, and it aligns perfectly with the gate.
So do you think this is the foundations?
Exactly. So you see the small stones below here, they're the foundation for this larger piece of stone. You see the same over there.
Okay.
So what we see is probably we're on the ancient land level around here, and then there's just been soil up.
It's very, very, very impressive, very interesting. And of course it could be something like that. If we have something like this here, you know, it's one of the, it's a unique example, not a unique, but there are very, very few examples for that kind of constructions for that period.
Yeah, I think I only know two or three.
Two or three.
Mm.
Very, very nice, very nice. So, congratulations, it's the only.
Yeah.
Our latest survey has revealed the direction of the road out of the city from the courtyard gate, which dates to either the classical or Hellenistic period. The new structure at the canal matches the road alignment perfectly, and its width is the same as the main avenue. Of course, a river's course will often shift over the centuries, but all signs point to this being a contemporary bridge in and out of the city. This fresh discovery makes it one of only a handful of examples from this period to be found across the Greek world. And, as Robin points out, it's likely to be one of several bridges in and out of the city.
Using other known examples as a guide, our fellow archaeologist Rich Potter of the University of Gothenburg in Sweden has created a 3D reconstruction of what the bridge may have looked like. We'll be back in future seasons to fully investigate the bridge, but for now, it adds an intriguing element to the story of our site.
So we've been doing resistivity in a few spots for last week. The first week was terrible. We were getting no data, nothing very good at all. The grain was just too wet.
It was too wet.
Yeah.
So we have, you know, in the medium stage.
Yeah. So when we did it last year, it was perfect. This year, just too wet. So we'll try again in spring. But Lawrence took the geophysics down here where we know we've got this big monumental gate thing. Possibly a tower gate, and he started to get actual good data, which is nice.
So we have impressive things.
Yeah, so you can see the walls really clearly.
Oh, come on, it's very clear.
These rooms here, and these as well, though. These amazing little rooms.
Oh, come on.
Also the road going through the gate.
The road, yes, and the gate is very nice.
And what's nice is that road points just out into the river, which is very cool.
Very thick walls there.
Massive
walls.
You can even see where they've been removed, and I guess for making lime, and I think this is probably a lime kiln.
Yes, it's just a distraction, but you know, you have the line of the wall.
Yeah, it's perfect, isn't it?
Oh, I understand.
So coming through here.
Oh, very nice. So I have the whole picture now.
Yeah.
And you see that they incorporate the Roman wall with the classic Hellenistic wall that it is at the south of the hill. So it's very, very nice. And really the junction, it's very nice to see it, at least digitally.
And the wall, both this wall and this wall, seem to kind of bend in for this big gate. So it must have been the main gate to get that. If we zoom in.
So the gate, you think it's also used during the Roman period also?
I think it was reused, yeah, because we've got this different area here where the wall seems to diverge slightly. And I think it's been maybe a second phase of wall here to fit the gate in with the later wall. But super cool, we got some results.
Okay, we were very fortunate this time. Maybe the weather didn't help at the start, but now it was you're a lion, so
we kept going, and the team have done really well.
Congratulations. great news.
While further investigation of the possible temple remains a hope for a future season, we've made some significant breakthroughs in reconstructing this ancient city in its various stages of occupation. As we consider our next move, it's fitting that our major discoveries of this trip are all directly connected to the physical thresholds of the city. A courtyard gate, a bridge, and even a terminus boundary marker remind us that we have only just stepped into this story.
End of a busy fortnight. Last day and the sun's shining on the project for once.
I didn't know it was going to be like this at the start of the day. But it's been a week of two halves. Week one, I've got to be honest, I was worried that it was going to be a wasted trip.
To be honest, week one was a bad time. I thought it was going to be a write-off. The ground was far too damp. The data was showing nothing new. We were putting in a lot of work with very little reward. It was quite hard going.
Because we targeted three areas, and so one was that courtyard villa that we spoke about, which really, my beautiful aerial drone shot with the snow marks showed more than your lovely resistivity.
Absolutely, area. Yeah. We added nothing new with resistivity. And the frustrating thing is, if we were to come back in spring, we might see something brilliant. So we have to do all that work again.
I know. But we've learned something. And it's the same with the temple, unfortunately. And the logic was absolutely well founded. Yeah, it's just up there behind us, higher ground, freer draining, but again, nothing. But it was that first day survey when we were just trialing the equipment and we picked up that the Roman wall initially.
Yeah.
And we could see it so clearly. And it sort of led to a bit of a new target, didn't it?
Yeah, well, I had to go off site for a few days and do some magnetometry on some earlier sites. And while I was gone, you moved the survey.
Sorry, not sorry?
Absolutely the right move. In hindsight.
It's funny, isn't it? Because we're sat on the wall now and it feels like a bit of a cop-out to do survey over known archaeology. Mm. And we know the feature is there because of the magnetometry survey that we did a few years back.
But what we really needed was to get a clear footprint of that gate. So we could see the internal structure, we could see how it was built, and we can crucially see which direction the road was going to. So getting that data was... It's blown me away, to be honest, how clear that shows up in the resistivity, considering all of the issues we've had with resistivity the last few weeks.
We've got pretty much the footprint of the gate.
Yeah.
We've got some internal divisions. We think we've got the later Roman gate as well.
You've also got the gate that is within the Roman wall, so we can see the actual intersection between the long since lost classical Hellenistic site as it was then and the newly freshly built Roman area inside the gate. It's incredible.
And then just as a huge bonus, Ian, having a bit of a rummage around down there by the drain, and
absolutely staggering. And I mean, all hats off to Ian. He spotted the stonework and he knew instantly it was something good. And I've never seen the river this low to be able to see that kind of stuff, but to spot fairly substantial architecture eroding from the canal bank is absolutely incredible. And it could be game changing. It feels very much like there's something brand new there, which for a season that for the first week felt like a complete washout is, it's classic last day discovery, isn't it?
Thing is, I'm going to look to the camera for this. Normally you'd watch Time Team and you think nothing really happens on the last day, but this is entirely last day discovery.
I know, I was writing a sort of mental script for this in my head, and it was going to be talking about how, oh, you can't always find new things. Archaeology isn't always setting out to achieve something and then doing it. And then we go and discover something brand new on the last day.
It's amazing. But I guess we should say this isn't the end of the project though. We've got plenty more seasons coming.
We've got plenty more seasons, and I think we're going to come back out later on and do some recording on that.
I mean, really, more trenches are needed.
I think we're at a point now where the best way to understand the site and our survey is to do some more excavation, and that's really where the project's leading on this site, coupled with survey in the landscape to place it within its wider context. The story of this site isn't this site alone, it's how it relates to the landscape, the villages, the towns, the farming, the resources. So we're investigating all of that.
And Lewis's work at the church fed into that perfectly in terms of looking at this courtyard villa in the initial data survey.
Massively,
him picking up this really important boundary marker that might possibly be linked to the site.
Exactly, yeah. We can see the occupants of this site and their relationship to the wider landscape really clearly by looking at other evidence in and around the place.
That's it.
But just watch this space for more Vlochos action.
Hopefully we can come back with Time Team and fill a slot in.
Fingers crossed.
Well, as it happens, we've already returned for another season and we've been doing some digging.
That's right, there comes a point when you just need to put trowel to soil and test out your survey results, and that's exactly what we've been doing.
And once again, we've captured all the action.
We even brought the British weather with us.
Now I'm sure that Robert's in Greece. It's all fun in the sun.
And we've made some more fascinating discoveries.
So make sure you subscribe to this channel to catch the next instalment of our investigations at Vlochos.
Join Time Team on Patreon to access exclusive 3D models, masterclasses, and behind-the-scenes insights.